TV Network, the solution for humanity.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونثني عليه الخير كله نشكره ولا نكفره ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو واحد أحد فرد صمد سبحانه عن الند تعالى عن الند وتعالى عن الشريك ونصلي ونسلم على خير الخلق نبي الهدى والرحمة نبينا محمد ابن عبد الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد Dear respected brothers and sisters Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh And welcome to a new episode from this series where we are discussing the art of differing. In the last episode, we mentioned a very important art that we need to master, which is the art of differentiating between what is major and what is minor, what is fundamental and what is not fundamental from an Islamic perspective. We mentioned certain guidelines, but I would like to mention in this episode the very fundamental guideline that helps us to differentiate between what is major and what is minor, which is what? Al-Ijma', the consensus of the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam is the criteria to judge between what is major and what is minor. Full stop, as simple as that. If the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam agreed upon, then that is considered to be something major and we don't accept any difference on this. However, the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam might agree on something which is considered to be one of the sunnah. And someone might disagree on this sunnah, not because he is going against the ijma', but he did not come up with the conclusion, he doesn't or she doesn't have knowledge. This is something else. Is this clear? I don't want to get into a technical discussion here. But generally speaking, if the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam agreed upon something, then this is fundamental. If the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam disagreed on something, then we don't say that it is minor, but differing on this is not a big issue. Is this clear, brothers and sisters? That's why we did not mention the issue of al-ijma' in the beginning, because otherwise people might have the illusion that anything that the Ummah did not agree on is minor and we can leave it. No. We said when the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam agree on something, then that is major, generally speaking, and we are not allowed to differ on it. Once the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam disagree on something, that is not considered to be minor, but we can accept differences, we tolerate differences, and that leads us to master the art of differences or the art of differing. Examples of things that the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam agreed upon, numerous, many. Take things in aqeedah and then take things in fiqh. In aqeedah, the whole Ummah agreed that Allah Jalla wa Ala is the only one who accepts the dua, and Allah Jalla wa Ala is the only one who is capable of doing things for us. Ala lahu al-khalq wal-amr. Many adilla, we cannot mention them now. The whole Ummah agreed that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is or was the final messenger, full stop. The whole Ummah agreed that the Sahaba in general were righteous people, and the Sahaba in general were trustworthy people. The whole Ummah agreed that the Mus'haf is the book that is between the two covers that we know. No one can say something is missing from the Quran or something has been added to the Quran. This is a matter of consensus, and this is a matter of aqeedah, and you can name it even to non-Muslims. We Muslims all agree that Isa, Jesus, is the Prophet of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. All of us agree that Musa, although it was sent to certain people, but we believe in him. آمن الرسول بما أنزل إليه من ربه والمؤمنون كل آمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر لا نفرق بين أحد منهم. A very fundamental principle, and you can name it. So the main articles of faith are considered to be major because the whole ummah agreed upon, and they are mentioned in numerous occasions in the Quran and Sunnah. Other things in fiqh, all of the ummah agreed that we have to pray 5 times. All of the ummah agreed that we have to pray Fajr 2 rak'ah, Dhuhr 4 rak'ah, Asr 4 rak'ah, Maghrib 3 rak'ah, and Isha 4 rak'ah. All of the ummah agreed that other than those 5 main salawat, there are supplicatory salawat or there are optional salawat. All of the ummah agreed that praying witr at night is something highly recommended. All of the ummah agreed on this. You can name it. All of the ummah agreed that fasting, we need to fast the month of Ramadan, which is the 9th lunar month. All of the ummah agree that after fasting, on the day of Eid, we are not allowed to fast and we have to establish the day of Eid. And you can name it. All of the ummah agreed that zakah is compulsory in gold and silver. And the zakah is 2.5. And we can go on and go on. So if the ummah agreed on something, we are not allowed to disagree with the ummah. And generally speaking, is considered to be a fundamental issue. If the ummah disagree on something, then we don't say that it is a minor issue. It is not fundamental, leave it. No. What we are saying that we are allowed to differ within the boundaries of the ummah means we are allowed to adopt A or B, and we are not allowed to invent opinion C that the ummah has not endorsed previously. There are many examples. Zakah of jewelry, whether to give it, not to give it. The ummah disagreed on this. The Hanafi school of thought said that you have to give it. The other school of thought said that you don't do it. Okay, so we are allowed to differ within this. The issue of marriage. There are certain aspects of marriage that the ummah disagree on. What is the level of dowry? Some scholars said it should be this amount. Some other scholars say it should be that amount. We are allowed to differ on this. What breaks wudu? We are allowed to differ on it. Sleeping, does it break wudu or doesn't break wudu? The ummah disagree on this. We can disagree on it. We cannot invent a new opinion. What does inventing a new opinion mean? Means neither of the two, neither of any party of the ummah adopted this opinion. So if, for example, Ghusl Yawm al-Jum'ah, having ghusl at the day of Jum'ah, the majority of the ummah said that it is highly recommended. Some scholars said that it is wajib. If someone said that it is not wajib, it is something optional, this is rejected. The whole ummah agreed that the hijab should be covering the body in a loose way. If someone said, no, I want to invent a new hijab and a tight body is allowed, that is not accepted. And we can carry on. I think the matter is clear. What is fundamental and what is not. Again, the point that I would like to stress, that if the ummah differ on something, then that gives us a room to differ. But that does not mean that this issue is a minor issue. The ummah disagreed on the zakah, whether to give zakah on jewelry or not to give zakah. Can we say that zakah is a minor issue? Or giving zakah on gold is a minor issue? You can leave it, you can wipe it out? No. None of the scholars said this. And we have to be careful. But we need to master this in order to be able to know how to differ. We need to master this in order to know how to differ. This is something important, brothers and sisters. Okay. So this explains to us what is major and what is minor. And having something which is considered to be minor, it doesn't mean that we should leave it. And we should also differentiate between a very fundamental principle that the Ummah agreed upon, and something that the Ummah disagreed upon, but it is not considered to be minor. Another point that need to be mentioned. If the Ummah agreed on something, all of the Ummah agreed on something, and someone goes against the ijma' of the Ummah, we have to be able to differentiate between a person going against the ijma' of the Ummah, the consensus of the Ummah, because of ignorance, he doesn't know, and this is not a very fundamental issue, and a person who is going against ijma' because he is opposing ijma' and he is rejecting what the Ummah agreed upon. So, if the Ummah agreed upon siwak, cleaning your teeth or mouth with the toothbrush or the miswak. By the way, once we say siwak, either using the stick or using the toothbrush is considered to be siwak, cleaning the mouth or cleaning the teeth. Even you can use your finger. This is siwak. The whole Ummah agreed that this is one of the etiquettes, the Islamic etiquettes. If someone said that, I disagree with this. Now we need to see, why does he disagree? Does he reject the Sunnah? Or he doesn't believe that Al-Islam came up with this Sunnah? Two things. If he is ignorant and he doesn't know, then he needs to be taught. And this is not one of the fundamental principles in Al-Islam that we have mentioned in the previous episode. Although it has been agreed by the whole Ummah, but this is not one of the fundamental issues, because if we add all the principles that we have mentioned in the previous episode and the issue of ijma' that we have mentioned now, we will come up with a conclusion that this is not a fundamental issue. This is different from someone rejecting salah. Salah, the whole Ummah agreed upon salah, and salah is one of the main pillars of Al-Islam. So if someone doesn't know that salah is wajiba, and that is difficult to believe. That is difficult to believe, that someone doesn't know that salah is one of the pillars of Al-Islam. And he needs to be taught, but our stance from this person is different from our stance from the one who doesn't know that siwak, cleaning the mouth, is considered to be sunnah. See, we are trying to master the art of differing. I hope that this is clear. So the person who is saying, no, siwak is not sunnah, out of ignorance, is different from a person who is saying, no, this is siwak. What do you mean by siwak? Someone cleaning his mouth? This is disgusting. Astaghfirullah al-Azim, astaghfirullah al-Azim. You are talking about the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that it is disgusting? No, I disagree. If he said this, then our stance from this person is different from our stance from the other person. Is the matter clear, brothers and sisters? We are discussing an intellectual topic. That's why you need to put attention, you need to pay attention to the discussion in order to benefit from it. Let us stop for a break, and inshallah we will continue after the break. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Where truth is hidden, misleading quotations create confusion. Where truth is hidden, lack of knowledge and wisdom cause upheaval and commotion. Where truth is hidden, manipulated scriptures and twisted facts emerge. This very hidden truth creates false propaganda, mayhem, chaos, disorder, and turmoil in our lives and the world order. But is there anyone with courage and wisdom? What is the truth? And who has the courage to expose it? Because it's your right to know the truth.
Watch Truth Prevail and Lies Perish in Truth Exposed by Dr. Zakir Naik. Next on Peace TV.
Where truth is hidden, misleading quotations create confusion. Where truth is hidden, lack of knowledge and wisdom cause upheaval and commotion. Where truth is hidden, manipulated scriptures and twisted facts emerge. This very hidden truth creates false propaganda, mayhem, chaos, disorder, and turmoil in our lives and the world order. But is there anyone with courage and wisdom? What is the truth, and who has the courage to expose it? Because it's your right to know the truth.
Watch Truth Prevail and Lies Perish in Truth Exposed by Dr. Zakir Naik. Tonight at 9 p.m. and repeat telecast at 7:30 a.m. UK on Peace TV.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala ashrafil anbiya'i wal mursaleen. Nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Welcome back, brothers and sisters. Just before the break, we were discussing the issue of how to differentiate between what is major and what is minor, what is fundamental and what is not fundamental. And we said, we gave the example of someone who does not accept siwak to be one of the sunnah. And we said that we need to differentiate between two types of people. This differentiation, what is the basis of this differentiation? The basis of this differentiation is the intention. Someone had good intention, but he doesn't know. Other than someone who knows, but he has bad intention, he's saying that this is disgusting. These are two different issues. Again, as we said, someone who disagree on this, which is siwak, is different from someone who disagree on salah, that salah is one of the pillars of al-Islam, and he doesn't want to pray because he doesn't believe that salah is one of the pillars of al-Islam. So this ability to differentiate between the people who differ from us is one of the arts of differing. This ability to differentiate helps us to be able to deal with those who differ from us. The one who differs from us on major fundamental issues is not like the one who differs from us on minor issues, or the motivation behind his views is acceptable or is innocent, means he is ignorant. We might elaborate on this in another art that, inshallah, will be discussed in the near future. Now, this discussion, brothers and sisters, leads us smoothly to the next art that we need to master, which is we need to strike a balance between the maslaha and the mafsada of anything that we do, the harm and the benefit of anything that we do. We need to have the weight of the maslaha and the weight of the mafsada. We need to apply the principles of striking the balance between maslaha and mafsada. And based on those principles, we can implement the previous guidelines that we have mentioned. Remember, brothers and sisters, we said one of the guidelines that we have mentioned is not to compromise on the principles, on the fundamental principles of al-Islam. And then we started to discuss what is fundamental and what is not fundamental. And we said that is one of the arts that we need to master. But when we identify what is major and what is minor, what do we need to do? We need to strike the balance. We need to maintain a balance. We need to weigh the mafsada and we need to weigh the maslaha. And based on the weight of both, we need to come up with a conclusion. Again, is a very vast topic and we cannot cover it in this series. However, again, there are certain guidelines to be mentioned here, and there will be useful guidelines. First of all, the issue of balancing between the maslaha and mafsada is a matter that all of the ummah agreed upon, all of the ummah, because there are so many verses in the Quran, there are so many verses in the sunnah that lead to this principle. Allah Jalla wa Ala says in the Quran in the beginning about al-khamr wal-maysir, فيهما إثم كبير ومنافع للناس. In both of them, إثم كبير, big إثم, and منافع, benefits for people. وإثمهما أكبر من نفعهما, and the إثم that comes from them is bigger than the منفعة, the sin, and the evil things that come from them is bigger than the منفعة or the benefit. He wants to tell us, you who are wise, if you have something that is the benefit of it is less than the harm of it, then what do you need to do? You should leave it. Allah Jalla wa Ala says in the Quran, من كفر بالله من بعد إيمانه إلا من أكره وقلبه مطمئن بالإيمان ولكن من شرح بالكفر صدرا فعليه غضب من الله. The one who is mu'min and then he commits kufr with pressure, Allah Jalla wa Ala is talking about him. من كفر بالله من بعد إيمانه إلا من أكره. The one who rejects iman without a valid reason, the one who is doing that for a valid reason, while his heart is firm on the haq, قلبه مطمئن بالإيمان, then this person is excused. Although this person might declare kufr openly, but his heart is firm on the haq. If he is what? If he is being tortured in a way that he cannot can handle, like Bilal. And this ayah was revealed to talk about Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu when he was tortured during the Meccan period, and they used to put rocks on his chest. So they used to tell him, insult Muhammad, insult Allah Jalla wa Ala, and he used to say, Ahadun Ahad. They said, have you left your religion? And he used to say, Ahadun Ahad. And then he came to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam explaining his situation, and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told him, as far as your heart is firm on the haq, then inshaAllah, don't worry, fa'in adu fa'ud. If they come back again and they tortured you, you can say something that gives the indication that you have left your religion. Here there is a maslaha, and here there is a mafsada. It is true that in this case, the sharia is telling us that you can do this. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, during the Meccan period, he was commanded not to retaliate, not to fight. Why? Because the mafsada of fighting is bigger than the maslaha of not fighting at that time. Although the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he used to see the Sahaba being tortured. This is a very delicate and vast topic. But the point is, all the scholars agreed that if the maslaha is bigger than the mafsada, we should give preference to the maslaha. If the mafsada is bigger than the maslaha, then the mafsada becomes the maslaha, and the maslaha becomes the mafsada. The benefit becomes a harm, and the harm becomes benefit. And we should give preference to the harm which turned to be a benefit. What do we mean by that? This rule is very, very important in this time and age. And this rule is very, very important for brothers who are living as minorities in non-Muslim countries. Let me give you an example. In non-Muslim countries, Muslims living as minorities, they have some fundamental differences between them. We should not speak about those fundamental differences, again, generally speaking, in public. Someone might say, we have to enjoin the good and forbid the evil. Yes, but privately, between ourselves. Our dirty clothes should not be in public. We should not put them in public. As simple as that. In fact, we should pretend that we are one ummah. And we should pretend as we and them are the same body. In front of the bigger society, in front of the government, in front of the non-Muslim society, we should be seen as one body. Why? Because the maslaha of being seen as one body is far greater than the maslaha of enjoining the good and forbidding the evil in public, or is bigger the maslaha that we are going to gain, generally speaking. Now, in some other circumstances, that situation might differ. I'm not talking about that, but I'm giving guidelines. Normally, the maslaha that we are getting from this is far bigger than the maslaha of claiming that we are different from them, claiming that openly, disclosing that openly. And that should be witnessed. Once we master that, we will be able to master the art of differing. It is an art. These are skills that we need to maintain in order to know how to differ. So if there is a situation where we are different, we are differing with other people, but these differences will lead to bigger harms, we should avoid putting these differences in public. I'm coming to the end of this episode. We have to stop here. We ask Allah Jalla wa Ala to give us righteousness and to make us among the people who listen and benefit. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
I am a Muslim, Islam my deen. Allah my Lord.
His word Quran.
Muhammad Prophet.
Praise be upon.
I am Muslim for all of time. Look at me now, family around my deathbed. I know not when Allah will call me home. The life I led, oh, what a blessed thing. As death comes to me, these words I will sing.
The value of money in the hereafter will be measured by its proper use in the present.
According to the glorious Quran, one of the best ways to use your money is to spend it in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by spreading His message of Islam. Peace TV is a non-profit Islamic satellite television channel that is primarily dedicated for just that cause, the proper presentation of Islam. It's a great choice to invest in it and a golden opportunity to purify your wealth in a way that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Support Peace TV. Send your zakat and donations to IRFI Al Rayan Bank, 47 Calthorpe Road, Birmingham, UK. B151TH. Pound account number 01132301. IBAN GB49ARAY 3000830113233 01. Sort code 300083. SWIFT BIC code ARAY GB22. Please confirm your contribution at support@peacetv.tv.
Support Peace TV, the solution for humanity.